The Constitution is charged with being inadequate to serve the Australian people into the 21st century.
Yes, Ms. Kiernan.
Thank you, Your Honour. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you're being asked to make a most significant decision for the future of Australia and her citizens. You are going to be asked to make a decision whether the Constitution is adequate to take Australia into the 21st century. The prosecution will focus on three main grounds to enable you to come to this view. The first ground is that Australia doesn't even have a Bill of Rights. Your precious rights and freedoms, such as freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, freedom of religion, are not guaranteed by the Constitution. In fact, those rights that you almost take for granted are not even written down anywhere. The second ground is that the Constitution imposes on Australia an offshore monarch and a local representative with powers that are both ill-defined and open to abuse. And the third ground is that the Constitution also imposes a state system, a federal system, and a splitting of powers between the federal government and state governments. Now that, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, gives rise to a buck passer's dream. It's on those three grounds and on the evidence that the prosecution will present that we will convince you that the Constitution is no longer adequate to take this country forward into the 21st century. Thank you, Your Honour.
Yes, Mr. Greenwood.
Thank you, Your Honour.
Members of the jury, today I appear for the Australian Constitution. The Constitution is innocent until it is proven guilty. We have to prove nothing. They must prove to you that the Constitution is inadequate. They must prove to you that Australia should discard its established system of government. They must prove to you that they have a better alternative. We have to prove nothing. The Constitution has served Australia well. We are a lucky country. We are a free and a successful country, and we should not jeopardise what we have. Thank you.
Yes, Ms. Kiernan.
Professor Blackshield, you're a professor of law at Macquarie University.
I am.
Professor, can you tell us whether Australians are guaranteed any personal rights under the Constitution?
Only very limited rights. There's a guarantee of the right to trial by jury. There are some provisions about freedom of religion and a couple of others. But first of all, they only apply as against the Commonwealth government. The states can interfere with any rights to any extent. And secondly, they've been given a very limited interpretation, both by the courts and, if I may say so, by barristers.
Mm-hmm. Are you telling the court that there really are very few basic freedoms guaranteed in the Constitution?
Hardly any. Mostly we depend on the so-called common law tradition to protect our rights, and once again, it's very vulnerable.
Professor Blackshield, could you explain what the common law is and how it operates?
Yes, the common law is the basic body of traditional law originally developed in England, but now carried to Australia, the United States, New Zealand, all of those countries that began as British colonies. And it's a body of law that was developed by English judges over the centuries, not written down in any simple rule book, but gradually built up through the accumulation of hundreds and hundreds of judicial decisions. So it's judge-made law, but part of the emotional significance of it, the value significance, is that when we call it common law, those judges who have gradually built it up and who continue to develop it are supposed to be reflecting the underlying values of the ordinary people, the community.
Mm-hmm. Professor, can you explain what a Bill of Rights is and how a Bill of Rights would be superior to the common law in protecting freedoms?
Precisely for the reason that an Act of Parliament can override the common law. Any rights that exist at the common law level can simply be wiped out by legislation. And the same is true of those rights that are guaranteed by Acts of Parliament themselves. For example, we've had some recent discussion of the Racial Discrimination Act in this country. It would be perfectly possible for the Commonwealth Parliament, which enacted the Racial Discrimination Act, simply to repeal it. So common law rights, even legislative rights, are vulnerable. A Bill of Rights enshrined in the Constitution sets limits on what even Parliament and government can do. The other thing that's important is that it creates rights which can definitely, in a clear-cut way, be enforced in an individual case by a court.
Yes. Thank you, Professor.
Mr. Green.
Thank you, Your Honour. Professor Blackshield, the essential reason you say we should have a Bill of Rights is to protect individuals from the excesses of government. Is that right?
Exactly so.
We do that pretty well right now, don't we?
We have a tradition which teaches us that we do it well, and in some ways it does, in some ways it doesn't. But an essential part of that tradition is the belief that in a system of democratic, responsible government, the Parliament acts as a limit on what the executive government can do. And I think in all Western democracies, not only in Australia, that parliamentary check on executive government gets weaker year by year.
But one of the difficulties with the Bill of Rights is that it sets in stone, as at today, what we perceive as being the significant rights for individuals, doesn't it?
This has been a problem with the American Bill of Rights, which hasn't been changed since 1791, and which still, for example, enshrines the right to bear arms, which is arguably quite inappropriate in 1993. But this is a problem of changing constitutions. Part of what we need to do in a wider constitutional debate is to establish the idea of our constitution as a people's constitution. You see, we're much more fortunate than the Americans. We do have in our referendum procedure a clear procedure by which we, the people, by a direct popular vote, can change our constitution at any time. And part of what we need to do is to get that mechanism working better.
Of course, we don't need to discard the Constitution in order to have a Bill of Rights, do we?
It would be possible to add a Bill of Rights to the existing Constitution.
And we don't need to discard the monarchy to have a Bill of Rights?
Oh, absolutely not. The question of Republic and Bill of Rights are almost irrelevant to each other, and I happen to think the Bill of Rights question is a far more important one than whether or not we have a monarchy.
International human rights expert Shelley Wright raised the issue of group rights and pointed to an international example.
The Canadian model does to some extent recognise Aboriginal rights. Now, I'm not suggesting that that has been entirely successful, and I think we should think very carefully about how we would want to include that in our own Bill of Rights. But I think it's something that should certainly be considered. I don't think the traditional individualistic model of a Bill of Rights will go very far to dealing with arguably our most serious problem of racial discrimination, and that is the question of Aboriginal rights.
Mr. Munns, you're an associate professor at the University of Queensland Law School.
That's correct.
In your opinion, has the Constitution adequately protected the rights of Australian citizens for the past 93 years?
Yes, in my opinion, the Australian Constitution has substantially contributed to the development of a free and democratic society. I would also like to say that, in my opinion, the rights that Australians have got are certainly protected by the courts interpreting the common law. And in this context, I would also like to point out very strongly, as a matter of fact, that rights are really part of the cultural tradition to which we belong. And indeed, the legal and cultural tradition is very much based on the assumption that we do have rights. And my concern is that the introduction of a Bill of Rights or the incorporation of a Bill of Rights in the Constitution is likely to adversely affect that tradition.
And in what way do you see it adversely affecting the tradition?
Bills of Rights are inevitably vague, general and ambiguous. And that means that the people who are called upon to interpret the Bill of Rights would have a splendid opportunity to read their own biases, their own philosophy and their own ideology into the Bill of Rights. This is a deplorable development, because if this were to happen, judges would become quasi-politicians. As a matter of fact, they would have their toes in the political grinder. And if they have their toes in the political grinder, they will deserve exactly the same respect that politicians deserve, namely, no respect whatsoever.
Yes, thank you, Professor.
Yes, Ms. Coonan.
Thank you, Honour. Dr. Munz, it's true, is it not, that the common law, or such rights as the common law can ensure, can in fact be overridden by legislation if Parliament was so minded?
That is indeed a fact, but I would not expect that to happen in a free democratic society. I say so because, as matters now stand, the Australian Parliament is entitled, is empowered to adopt human rights legislation, and it has done so on numerous occasions. For example, in 1975, the Australian Parliament adopted the Racial Discrimination Act, which prohibits people from discriminating against others on the grounds of race. In contemporary Australia, there appears to be an obsession with rights. Obviously, we know that once person's right is another person's duty. And in my opinion, we should more concentrate on duties. We should think about duties for the very simple reason that by concentrating on duties, we become aware of the moral consequences of what people are doing.
Yes. Whilst duties are no doubt a civic virtue to be lauded, wouldn't it be preferable to have a Bill of Rights which fills in the gaps and sets out at least clear guidelines to guarantee people their basic human rights?
Well, that in itself is going to be impossible for a number of reasons. First of all, it is unreasonable to expect that reasonable people will be able to agree on which rights should be incorporated in a Bill of Rights. And secondly, as I pointed out before, a Bill of Rights inevitably consists of a vague, indeterminate and ambiguous language, and therefore that will lead to uncertainty in the law. In fact, no individual in Australia, no member of parliament, no political party will be able to predict how the provisions of the Bill of Rights would be interpreted. In a way, a Bill of Rights is an empty vehicle which enables judges to achieve whatever result they would like to achieve. Even 2 years ago, the freedom of expression provision of the American Constitution was used for the purposes of stipulating that people have the right to dance in the nude in a bar. Now, this may well be a very interesting right to have, and it may even provide us with some titillating entertainment, but is it really one of the rights that should be enshrined in the Constitution?
So basically, the Constitution provides a structure.
But then what you're saying is, okay,
Just let me finish what I'm saying.
Well, you said
the structure of the Constitution is such as to enable the judges to administer the law, including the Constitution, which is interpreted by the High Court of Australia, which is interpreted by judges who are appointed because of their academic and legal achievements and their ability to deal with such things. They're appointed by as good men. Men who are seen by their peers and by the community generally.
You know, women are...
Yes, but they judge something on a subject on a result of someone, a judge, had made a decision in 1756 in England. Who gives a shit?
Why, no, the decision... Sorry, surely the decision is between whether or not you guard people's rights
in the Constitution by a Bill of Rights or with legislation which is initiated by government?
Well, I think a Bill of Rights at some point in time will be outdated and
needs to be changed by a referendum.
And enforcing people's rights, you know, coming up with the criteria to enforce the rights, is just going to become monumental.
The more mechanisms and the more laws that you have, the less freedoms you might have.
Absolutely.
Brett, you haven't had a say yet. What do you think?
Actually, I think I agree with Chanel. I think it'll be outdated, just as this whole thing is all about. Is the Constitution outdated?
It must go down to a referendum for any change to take place. As an Aboriginal person, I was told not until 1967 that I was an Australian citizen, brought down by a referendum.
Can I interrupt you? Catherine, we haven't heard from you at all yet.
Yeah, perhaps rather than a Bill of Rights, we should aim for a charter which encompasses principles like, which will see us through and which we'll never need to change, such as, you know, number one,
utopia.
Ecological... Well, why not aim for utopia? Why not have high ideals?
Plato wanted a utopia.
Life I'd like to get away from cynicism.
Gay people, for example, in many societies they would have no rights at all. If
but they still
fathers,
had the right to vote.
If the founding fathers had,
if the founding fathers had
drawn up a Bill of Rights, people would have had a right to a heterosexual monogamous marriage, and presumably probably only a Christian one at that. Now, I'm sure in today's enlightened age, with the sexual liberation and so on, and particularly here in Sydney, it would not go down too well if the only sort of sexual activity was permitted under the Bill of Rights. Was monogamous, heterosexual.
No, we could change the Constitution, presumably.
Well, Russell, that doesn't even come into the rights of an Aboriginal person being gay or otherwise.
The Bill of Rights will just be amended to the Constitution. You change it in the same way.
Yes, because Russell, as you said, a gay person still had the right to vote.
The Soviet Union had a very good Bill of Rights, right? A very good Constitution. And that made no difference to Stalin. The evidence historically of a Bill of Rights is that it doesn't necessarily protect people.
I don't think you can be very complacent, though, about Australia having a democratic tradition and therefore everything is okay. I mean, if we actually look at the human rights record in Australia, I don't think it's as good as people claim it to be. I mean, if you look at
deaths
in custody, for example.
Do you not understand that Parliament is for the people? And Dimitri, do you want judges to be politicians as well?
No, but do you understand?
Yes, I do.
Do you understand that how the politicians are elected?
Yes,
do you?
Yes, I do.
Do you know that I can have a party with 49% taking the election and not elect one representative?
That's how Labor keeps winning, yes, we know that.
The question should be not, should the Constitution have a Bill of Rights? The question really is this Constitution adequately serving our human rights and our rights? Not whether we should have one or not, but whether... No, that is the question. That's the charge.
This is the charge in court.
The Bible in your hand, faces honour, silence. The evidence you're about to give in this case shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Please say, so help me God.
So help me God. Ms. Coonan.
Thank you, Your Honour. Mr. Turnbull, you're chairman of the Prime Minister's Republican Advisory Committee and a director of the Australian Republican Movement, are you not?
That's correct.
Could you explain for us the terms of reference of the Republican Advisory Committee?
The committee's terms of reference require it to set out the options by which Australia could replace the British monarch as our head of state with an Australian selected by Australians, and to do so in a way which will maintain our existing system of parliamentary government.
And what would be the changes necessary to establish Australia as a republic?
Well, within the terms of reference that we've been given by the government, the principal areas of substantive change are only two. First, you have to agree on and set out a means of selecting or electing or appointing the head of state and a means of removing that that office holder. And second, you have to decide how you are going to deal with the powers of the head of state.
The most controversial of these, the so-called reserve powers, were invoked by Sir John Kerr in the dismissal of the Whitlam government in 1975.
They describe the circumstances in which the Governor-General can act contrary to the advice of the Prime Minister.
Are these carefully set out and defined in the Constitution?
No, they're not set out anywhere in the Constitution, or indeed anywhere else. And the scope and extent of the reserve powers is, to say the very least, contentious. The fundamental problem is that people don't agree what they are. I mean, if the Senate blocked the budget now, and there would be no consensus in the law, in the texts, in the community, as to how the Governor-General should react. And I think that's a very unsatisfactory situation. The problem with leaving this area a black hole, as I've described, is that whenever that circumstance arises, it is inevitable that the head of state will be drawn into a violent political controversy. Whereas if you have some rules laid down, which are perfectly clear, then people will accept, they may not agree with it, but they will accept the legitimacy of the head of state's action in the same way as they accept the legitimacy of court decisions, even though they may not agree with them.
What advantage would a president give us over a Governor-General?
Well, the principal advantage of the change is that it means that we have as our head of state, and of course the head of state is the Queen, not the Governor-General. He is the Queen's representative in Australia, no more than that. Having an Australian as head of state means that we will ensure that all of our national institutions and symbols are unequivocally Australian. The problem with the Queen is, in the Australian context, is that she does not represent or symbolise or evoke the Australian nation. We demand of all of our politicians, of our judges, of our leaders, that they have a unique and unequivocal commitment to this country and no other. And yet we have at the top of our constitutional pyramid someone whose principal and overriding commitment must and always will be to the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. And that, to my way of thinking, is an affront to our national dignity.
Thank you, Mr. Turnbull.
Thank you.
Mr. Turnbull, even you would agree that the Constitution has served us well for the past 93 years, I take it.
Well, it depends what you mean by served us well. We haven't had a revolution or an insurrection, but I think in some circumstances the Constitution served us poorly.
Now, you have suggested that the reserve power should be codified. Mm. Do you suggest that any additional powers should be given to the President if there were to be a republic?
No, I don't think there's any need for additional powers, and if you gave the head of state additional powers, you would be moving beyond the minimal approach. I mean, the minimal approach basically means no more than this, that we would have an Australian president, selected by Australians in some manner to be agreed, who would have the same powers and functions as the Governor-General.
And so you would envisage that the president would have precisely the same powers as the Governor-General had in 1975?
Well, indeed. I mean, that's right.
But the difference that you'd propose is that the ways in which those powers could be exercised would be set down in writing rather than treated as conventions.
Well, yes, I think it is much better to write the conventions down. The difficulty with doing that, of course, is in those areas where there is, in effect, no convention, and 75 is a classic example.
That is the very difficulty with what you're proposing, that you are seeking to draft for situations that you cannot envisage.
Let me say this to you. I am content to leave the lack of consensus and convention about the role of the head of state in the event of Senate blocking supply, to leave it exactly as it is. Okay, I'm sure we'll muddle along. I don't think it's going to be the end of the world. All I'm saying is that it wouldn't be a bad idea if people could agree on some mechanism to agree on one. But
in later testimony, Mr. Turnbull maintained the Queen would have conflicting loyalties in a constitutional crisis.
You're not suggesting, however, though, that she would act contrary to the interests of Australians, are you?
I've got no doubt that she will act, she would always act in accordance with what she and her advisers perceive to be the interests of Australians. Whether that is consistent with the views of the Australian government is anybody's guess. I mean,
in relation to the election or appointment of this president, you have suggested that it should be done not by the people, but by the politicians. Is that right?
Well, let me explain. The approach that I prefer is that the head of state, the president, called the president, should be appointed by a two-thirds vote of both Houses of Parliament sitting together. The consequence of that, and I mean, and you could do it sitting separately too if you wished, I mean, it's a, the point is that a two-thirds majority, be it in a joint sitting or in separate sittings, requires the support of government and opposition, which would mean that the head of state would not be the political appointee of one party and would have bipartisan support.
And dismissing a president?
Again, a two-thirds majority. And take the view that if two-thirds of the members of parliament wish to remove the head of state, then the head of state has clearly got to the point where he or she has lost the confidence of both major political groups.
Well, finally, we're aware of your stated desire to be Prime Minister. Do you also regard yourself as having the qualities of a president?
Well, I'm not aware of ever stating that I desire to be Prime Minister, but I've got no doubt it's been attributed to me at various times.
I remind you, you're on oath.
Constitutional expert Michael Cooper explained the relationship between the Constitution and the High Court.
Yes, well, the role of the High Court is to interpret the Constitution. If you're looking at a copy of the Constitution, you should just keep in mind that that document can't tell you everything you need to know about it. It operates against a background of customs and traditions and conventions. There are implications that need to be drawn from it. And matters of dispute arise in relation to what it means, and that's where the High Court comes in.
Silence. The evidence you're about to give in this case shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Please say, so help me God.
So help me God.
Yes, Mr. Greenwood.
Thank you, Your Honour. Mr. Waddy, you are a Queen's Counsel and the convener of Australians for a Constitutional Monarchy.
That's so.
And could you tell the members of the jury, please, the essential features of Australia's constitutional monarchy?
In how many minutes? Well, we have a system which we inherited. It started in 1066 when England was conquered, and that travelled well until there was a republic under Cromwell. And then in 1688 there was a restoration, and from that time on the Crown has always had to act basically on advice. That system came to Australia and is part of Australia, an essential part of Australia, from 1788 onwards. It is the foundation of government in each of our states. It is the foundation of government in the Commonwealth. We sometimes call it a crowned republic because all the power emanates from the people, because the Crown, the essential theory is the Crown can do no wrong. You think, wow, that's pretty good. But the Crown can do no wrong because the Crown always acts on advice. Save, as Miss Cooner no doubt remind me, when it exercises the reserve powers and calls an election.
Can you see any advantage in having a president over our current system with a Governor-General?
No. No, I can't.
Do you see specific difficulties with it?
Yes, I do.
What are they?
Well, I really agree with Barry Jones, the head of the ALP, on this. He would not want to see a president head of the executive government. I wouldn't want someone to be given the great powers to call Parliament, to dismiss Parliament, to appoint any ministers they like and command the armed forces, have them a party politician, and give them a mandate for 4 or 5 years. I mean, the marvellous thing about the Governor-General is what he's got all these marvellous powers. He's only there at the Queen's pleasure, which means on the Prime Minister's advice. So he is subject virtually to instant recall. He's got huge powers, but if he ever tried to use them, he'd be recalled. And the same with the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister gets all the other powers, but if he doesn't use them properly, if he's illegal, he can be dismissed. If he doesn't get the money, he can be dismissed. But most of the time, he's just rolled in the Cabinet, or rolled in the Parliament, or rolled by the Senate. We've got a marvellously flexible system of our own, which we Australians have worked out, and I think we're mad to change it. The system of the monarchy is that it's the one position which is beyond politics. Now, the Queen has no personal power, as Mr. Turnbull said, and I thoroughly disagree with what he said about the Queen taking English advice in Australian affairs. That's grossly improper, and I don't believe the Queen ever would.
How do you see that Australia could have a republic without affecting the system of government as you see it as being so important to Australia?
I don't believe it can safely.
Thank you.
Mr. Waddy, how do you see any difference between a presidential head of government and the Governor-General?
I think the Governor-General is a unit. in terms of powers because he has no mandate from anyone. If he turns up and says, I think this, someone says, well, so what? You're not elected by anybody. I mean, we're all Democrats.
But why would that be any different if there was a president without a change of conventions and without any basic change to the Constitution apart from substituting the president as the head of government?
Because he would be someone in his own right. He's the person who's going to epitomise Australia, take us into Asia. He's the one everybody wants. He's the one, if you read the polls, they want 46% want him to have the powers of the Governor-General, another 30% want him to have the powers of the President of the United States and the power to dismiss Prime Ministers. I mean, he's going to be a very popular figure. That would totally distort our system.
Why isn't it an adequate safeguard to have, against your argument for a political appointment, or that that person represents a political appointment, if such a person was appointed by bipartisan houses of parliament and approved by two-thirds majority?
I've never heard such fairy floss nonsense. The thought that Pollies would not come to a deal immediately and tic-tac, I think is what Mr. Barry Jones says, you tic-tac, your Polly this time, my Polly next time. The idea that we won't have a politician there if we give them any power is just absolutely risible. No one in here would believe that. I'm sorry, Your Honour.
But why do we need an offshore monarch? She's a bit like, is she not an offshore company?
Well, I wouldn't mind a dividend, but... but
no doubt one might come.
But you see, when you look at it, there's no real... I didn't hear that, Your Honour. Could I have that repeated? You see, when you come to a company director, for instance, if I can say so without being treasonable, many people hold positions in different companies and they apply the advice and their minds to that. Now, the Queen is Queen of the United Kingdom, certainly, but also of Canada. No one wants independence from there. New Zealand, New Guinea, no one wants independence from there. And Australia. You can go on. I mean, it's a titular position at the head of a system of government. Now, if you don't like the Queen being overseas, you'll have to get one here. Change the Act of Succession and have one here. But don't change our whole system of government.
When the prosecution raised the Whitlam dismissal, Mr. Waddy went on the attack.
I refuse to admit there was a constitutional crisis in 75. I believe there was a political crisis, and I really believe, and I said so at the time, the Constitution solved it brilliantly. We got an election, we got a government we wanted, and we all went on with our business.
Would you agree that as a result of the events of 1975, whichever view one takes on them, that there is a case for codification of the reserve powers if we were, as a mature people, to sit down and try to define them?
No, I don't. I think it would be disastrous.
Why do you think they should just remain at large?
Because I think you appoint someone of integrity to the position of Governor-General, and once in 100 years he's asked to exercise his discretion, and the complaint made is he did it too quickly. Wow.
The last word went to Mr. Waddy in defence of the Constitution.
Can I say this? You don't look at the marriage licence to see how the marriage is working, and you don't have to look at the Constitution to see how Australia is working.
Malcolm Turnbull was pretty impressive, didn't you think?
He looked extremely nervous and ill at ease.
Nervous?
I don't think his Prime Minister who appointed him is likely to be there much longer either.
No, we're not here to discuss that, Russell.
Brett?
He said one interesting thing that really took sense, me being the youngest here. He did say that make the Constitution clear and easy for all Australians to understand. Now, once that happens, well then, we're on our road home.
There seem to be two clear issues to me. One of them is, do we want a president, an Australian head of state, a peculiarly Australian head of state, or do we want a monarch who is also a monarch of another country? So do we want a queen or a president? Seems to me one issue. The second issue seems to me, what sort of powers do we want to give our head of state, whether it be a queen or a representative of a monarch? In other words, do we want to prescribe the powers that they have and write them down more clearly than they are now?
I was actually thinking back to the time when I became an Australian citizen about 3 years ago, and the first act I had to do as an Australian citizen was swear allegiance to the Queen, and I felt that the first act that I did as an Australian citizen was an act of treachery because I did not believe in the Queen. And it seems to me that it starts right from there. I mean, she comes back to the symbol of who is Australia, what is Australia about, an Australian identity, and I don't think she reflects cultural diversity of Australia. I mean, equally, I cringe every time I see, you know, I'm as Australian as Ampol, billboards all around, you know, the city, and that doesn't mean Australia to me either. I don't think that the people who were put up in front of us as witnesses were representing the voices of Australia. I mean, they were all really academic, very legalistic. They weren't really accessible to people like me as an average citizen.
But maybe what they are doing is providing a reference point where the debate sure. can continue further.
Absolutely.
You know, and I think the major point that I got from it is, okay, this is the opportunity where we can readdress what our national symbols are and should be and what our national symbols are going to be over the next 100 years.
The weak point of Malcolm's argument was that the only difference is in the symbols. So why not change the symbols? Why not change the flag? Why not change all our visible symbols to the world, but keep the constitutional monarchy?
And I agree. Right? Because the thing that really came across for me was Malcolm Turnbull said that the Queen on occasions would act in, not always in Australia's interest. Could act not always in Australia's interest. And then Lloyd Waddy refuted that, and really this is the case, and this is the truth of the matter, the essence of the matter. Lloyd Waddy said the Queen will not and never can take advice from British ministers about Australia. She can only ever be advised by Australian ministers and act on that.
I think one good example, and we should always remember, and this is no disrespect to the Governor General at the present moment, who's Bill Hayden, but Bill Hayden has been an advocate for a Republican for many, many years, and everybody knows that. Bill Hayden was recommended by the Prime Minister at that time, and that was Bob Hawke, to the Queen to be Governor General. Now, if the Queen was objecting or didn't have any interest to Australia, would she recommend or appoint somebody who's pro-Republican? Of course not. She's not against Australia.
I don't think she's for. No, she we're not for, suggesting
she,
that.
And, yes, you are. You're suggesting that because that? Simply because she is from. No, can I just? I think you are. You're simply saying that she's against Australia because she doesn't live in Australia. She's not Australian. But she represents the Commonwealth, and we as Australians are part of that Commonwealth, and we should remember that.
Keeping the monarch reinforces the idea that Australia is a colony, and the world over colonies are renowned for destruction of cultural diversity, religious beliefs, whole peoples being destroyed, colonists who go in there and just use the country as a quarry. And the other reason is, by keeping the Queen, we are reinforcing the idea that the only acceptable migrant is a British one.
The most important reason for against monarchy is any monarch is not elected. What's wrong with you people? That's you are against reason. Democracy.
A monarch.
We're talking about an elected person.
But it brings me to my point.
You have it.
No, the thing is, but the thing is, Jonathan. Where
you live in 1993 or what?
Can I
sit
down, Russell?
Sit down, Russell.
If
you're going to allow this jury to be dominated,
Russell, sit down. Russell, sit down.
Oh, hang on, Russell. Who's overbearing?
We want to live in a multicultural society without the reign of the monarchy, which monarchy means one rule. Mono.
Can I make a humble comment?
Yes, you can, yes. Armando. Humility would be welcome. Let's have a humble comment from Armando.
In my opinion, we really, in practice, we have a republican system. We don't call it that way. But if we have a republic in fact, and we don't have it in theory, all we have to do is adjust the paperwork.
I'm just questioning whether we actually need to have a president at all, whether we need anybody in that position at all.
I guess we've got a parliament.
Why not just have a parliament and not have a president at all?
I'm for that.
If we're going to change the system and opt for a republic, as opposed... is this funny or...?
No, that was a comment.
Sorry.
Is anyone in this room have actually any objection of going to a referendum with this question?
The biggest problem with a referendum, though, is the way the Constitution is structured. If you don't have bipartisan support and strong bipartisan support for a referendum question, it will never get through. Okay.
If the President is the head of state, he will have final powers.
Well, if it's put to a vote and the people elect whether it be a president or whatever,
right. I mean,
we could nominate Dimitri here for our next president.
Yeah. Yeah.
Prosecution witness against the states, Elaine Thompson, went straight to the duplication of state and federal functions.
The schools,
supposed to be a state-level decision-making apparatus, and yet, of course, it's up to the Commonwealth to give them the money, and they direct the money and determine, ultimately, the broad shape of policy. And again, you've got this splitting of responsibility so that we end up saying, well, who's responsible for education? Who do we hold accountable? The state of our health system, God help us all. Excuse me, Your Honour. You know, each state blames the centre because they say, we'd love to give you better hospitals, we'd love to provide you with a better medical service. We can't because the Commonwealth doesn't give us the money. The Commonwealth says, we give them plenty of money. It's up to the states to determine how they spend it. We're not responsible for the state of the public hospital system. You've got split accountability, and ultimately, split accountability means no accountability at all. As you may or you should be aware, one of the most critical problems for Australia is our water system. The Murray-Darling system is at critical point in salinity, and if you live in Adelaide, you can barely drink the water, and the prediction is that it will become totally undrinkable very shortly. They have been attempting to deal with the problem of the Murray-Darling system now with a Murray-Darling Commission for many, many years, but it involves three states and a central government cooperating, and it's much easier not to cooperate, to dump the problems further and further downstream until they all end up in Adelaide's lap.
And can state governments be reformed, or is the solution simply to abolish the states?
Well, this is where I get onto my high horse, and I would think that it's very sensible with a country of 17 million people to abolish the states. To begin with, we're not that talented at producing a lot of quality politicians, especially in the small states. And you're really asking a lot to come up with a lot of high-quality politicians for each of the state governments. We'd be better off, I think, trying to get the quality moving in one direction.
She then suggested to the jury an alternative.
I think that if we could wipe the slate clean and start off with a central government and very strong administrative regions, which aren't power centres in the terms of elected politicians, but are strong regions, like many countries in the world have. After all, Britain has a one government, a unitary government, and has very powerful regional administrative centres. We could have these centres around where economic power makes sense. We would have the capitals, but we could also have the dream of, say, Albury-Wodonga, which at the moment crosses state lines, as an economic unit. Centralia, which would include all the three large Aboriginal peoples, could become a unit centred around Alice Springs. The northern part of Queensland could develop as an economic unit. And there wouldn't be these vested interests in the state capitals actually operating against that.
Thank you, Associate Professor. No further questions.
This is a pretty radical suggestion.
Absolutely. Though been around for a long time.
Am I right in understanding your position to be that we replace these state governments, these state bureaucracies, with regional bureaucracies?
To some extent, what you're saying is correct. We must have some sort of government institutions to run policy. What we're not reproducing is another set of elected governments playing more party politics with our fate, with accountability. Political accountability is not divided. We will know who to blame. It's those devils in Canberra.
Why wouldn't we blame the regional bureaucrats as well?
If you want to blame the bureaucrats, I'm happy for you to blame them as well and build a good system of appeal, administrative appeal systems, have ICAC type bodies oversighting bureaucrats. I'm quite happy to extend the system to blame the bureaucrats as well as the politicians.
But the whole
what
idea...
I'm suggesting is we've simplified it by getting rid of one bunch of elected political politicians.
When we don't like what the state governments do, we dump them. You're suggesting we replace them with people that we can't get rid of.
We can't get rid of the bureaucrats anyway. whether they are out of the central government or out of the state governments. We can't get rid of our bureaucrats, whichever system we're
using.
But
we can send a message to them by voting out the government in power within the state.
I wish we did send messages to bureaucrats through the things we do when we vote in and out governments. It just doesn't seem to work that way very often. This way we can send messages because we've got one set of politicians to send the messages to in the policy areas, and they can't slough off the responsibility for that policy to some other set of elected politicians.
Dr. Thompson has suggested that we should have regional administration departments. Can you see any way in which that would be a better system or a more efficient system?
No, I don't. I'm certainly for a strong local government as well. What I said for the states certainly applies there. But I can't see how we can save on administrative outlay if we create, say, 40 or 50 regional governments. All we would get instead of a saving would be less parliamentary control of the administration. Everything would have to be controlled only by central government in Canberra. What I would see is a proliferation of local duchies without any parliamentary control. I would see a diminution of proper democracy. It is no coincidence, I believe, that most stable, long-lasting democracies like Switzerland, the United States, Canada, have been federations, and that quite a few other countries are moving that way.
Professor Casper saw competition between the states as one solution to our trade deficit.
We are now open to the world. We have to be competitive. It is very essential for that task that government helps us to become internationally competitive. And it is quite essential in that we have a school for competing administrations, in that we allow different state governments to compete with each other. They will develop alternative solutions how we can best compete in the world. They will offer international investors different solutions, and that in turn will make us as a nation much more attractive to capital, to know-how, to enterprise, which we need, I think, for higher living standards.
During questioning about corruption and maladministration in state governments, Professor Casper offered this defence.
The real reason why this is so, in my opinion, is this. The states have been emasculated. We get more and more what I call fiscal centralism, central tax raising power and handout to the states, which means that if the states increasingly administer money for which they are not responsible. I would make the states more responsible for the tasks that they finance by forcing them to raise their own funds.
Professor Casper, do you think we could get an unequivocal assurance that there would be, read my lips, no more taxes if all these powers, the power to raise money was passed back to the states?
Would you like that assurance from a politician?
Do you think we'd get one, Professor Casper?
Not from a politician ever.
Professor Casper, do you agree that there is a lot of expensive and unnecessary duplication of regulations and services from state to state?
I do agree, and as far as duplication of regulation is concerned, one reason why many people want to do away with the states, I would like to point to this, namely that competing ideas about regulating things can be a discovery procedure. We have duplication in industry. Who, for example, designs the best motor car? There are duplications of teams that design it. In the Soviet Union, we have one centralized team, and I must say they haven't produced very good motor cars. On the other hand, I would certainly argue for the so-called rule of origin, which is that if a product is lawfully produced on health and safety and other grounds in one state, it should be sold legally throughout the Commonwealth.
Basically, Casper's argument was that the duplication of services provided competition. But unfortunately, what has happened in Australia, that the duplication of those services has meant that we haven't been able to achieve economies of scale. In a country of only 17 million people, we've got, you know, six railway networks where none can interconnect. One of the big reasons why we're not exporting enough is that our transport costs and communication costs are too high because they're split over six states.
I have actually worked within a Commonwealth body, and I could see that there are definite inconsistencies between states in terms of resources and the way that things are actually, mechanisms are, you know, put into practice. Mm. And there needs to be some sort of an overview at a Commonwealth level.
Do you want to have a separate here?
Honourable Helen Shem Ho said something that hit the nail on the head, I reckon.
Power tends to corrupt. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. So if you have check and balance, then there is no absolute power. And the state is in a very appropriate place to check this power.
I thought that made sense to me. As a young'un here today, I know all of you are much more older, much more educated and wiser. And Okay, sorry, maybe not as good looking.
Without the states, and we can have this distribution of power, we have local governments, we have the municipalities, and they can actually work much, much better and much, much closer to the people with 100th of the cost.
This Good. Is all about control, and I do not want somebody from Canberra or Adelaide, as Miss whatever her name was, is stating that we should go to control our lives. I think smaller government, more government, and it's possibly, to me, reaching out to the people is better for us, the people, to have a say. If we all centralise it into Canberra, I mean, how many people of us go and see the Prime Minister today? Huh? None of us.
How many people go and see the Premier?
But you must have a government, be it state or centralised or whatever, that actually accommodates and gives us what we want, gives us what the people want, like hospitalisation, which has been taken away. But you see it all the time. Hospitals are closing down, for God's sake. You go to the hospital and say you've got cancer. They say, go home and wait for 6 months. You could be dead in one month.
When you're ready to die, come back.
Exactly.
Who controls your Medicare? Government, your federal government, doesn't it? It's a centralised body, isn't it? Administration comes from the state.
Well, they're the ones that administer all the money.
The money comes from federal.
Yeah, but hang on. But then
and
you
when
can
you
be,
turn it all around, it comes from the taxpayers' pocket.
Yeah, that's exactly. True. You're right in that.
I think you're truthing him here.
I think what we need to do is perhaps look at some duplication and say, all right, let's cut down this function. Let's give that function to the federal government only and give the other function to the state government only, and then the rest, which are smaller, more people-oriented to the council.
What about Elaine's idea of decentralising some of the departments and some of the bureaucracy from Canberra out and having stronger regional governments rather than state governments?
Yeah.
I mean, how representative of Cape York is the state government in Brisbane anyway?
If a small municipality has one issue, it will not influence a central power government. It will be impossible. So they'll have to band together and form states, whether they're ones in Western Australia, ones in New South Wales, ones in Northern Territory anyway.
I really believe that less government is a better idea, and the system as we have it now, we have so many tiers. So here we are, the general public down here, and we've got God knows how many tiers before we get to the top. And the more complex it becomes, the more remote we become from it.
Mm. You're agreeing with that, are you, Russell?
Very much so. In Britain, it's called the unitary system of government. But basically, as I see it, it boils down to this, that only the most minimal number of powers should be given to Canberra, so long as the jet plane still flies, it could be the central capital, and defence and the very obvious ones, and all other powers vested in large regional governments.
I think the power should actually be with the people in local areas, and I'd say that have a national body to oversee all the things that are universal to the country, and then let local areas decide their own issues. So yeah, I'd go for power with people in local areas.
And if the people is corrupt, you don't change the system, you change the people that are corrupt and keep the system.
That's right.
Oh no, but it's the system that has allowed them.
If the system is corrupt, there is not such a thing. There is not such a thing as a corrupt system. Come on.
Have a look now at the matter in its broadest sense. We've been asked to judge the performance of the Constitution in three areas, and three areas only. Those are, should we have a Bill of Rights, that the Constitution is inadequate in that it doesn't provide us with a Bill of Rights, that the Constitution is inadequate because it doesn't provide us with an Australian head of state with prescribed powers, and that the Constitution is inadequate because it gives us a federal system that involves duplication by giving us the states as well as a federal system. So taking all of those three things into consideration and the evidence that you've heard in court today, I want you to vote. And I want you to decide whether the Constitution is guilty of the charge that it is inadequate to serve the needs of the Australian people into the 21st century. So I'm going to go around the room and ask for a guilty or a not guilty. Mary, we start with you. Is the Constitution guilty or not guilty?
Well, I think it's guilty of being inadequate, of taking us as Australian people, multicultural people, into the 21st century, not just for me, but for my children, their children and their children.
Dimitri?
Guilty.
Guilty.
Andana?
Not guilty.
Not guilty.
Not guilty.
Okay. Nahid?
Not guilty.
Armando?
I don't think the Constitution is guilty of anything, but it certainly needs to be updated and changed and modified to suit the real situation.
Catherine?
Guilty.
Although the Australian Constitution hasn't done anything bad, the question is it adequate for the 21st century and adequate for Australia's needs in the 21st century? I think it's absolutely guilty.
Jonathan?
I think it's not guilty because I think it has worked, and I believe it's not guilty because I care about what happens to people, and I think under another system they'll be worse off.
The Constitution's been put on notice. Five guilty, five not guilty, one with a foot in each camp. That's not the end of the case, however, for the jury that ultimately counts, all Australians, whose verdict on the Constitution is still to come.